So, hello, dear sisters and brothers. Welcome to the Faith Perspective. I'm Andrea Chuck, knocking off, of course, things in the morning. And also, we have Beatrice de Cruz with us.
Yes.
And on Faith Perspective, of course, it's an opportunity for us to look at trending issues, things that are happening in the church and in around the world, and of course, in our Archdiocese.
Yes, so inaugurated on 10th of February 2023, the Archdiocesan Pastoral Council, that's the APC, is a consultative body of laypersons, clergy and religious, assisting in the formulation of a 10-year pastoral plan for the Archdiocese in Singapore.
That's right. Mm. And so in the studio today, there are no strangers to us. We have, once again, the co-chairs of the Archdiocesan Pastoral Council, Father Adrian Danker and Kwek. Welcome, gentlemen.
Good morning.
Thank you so much, and thank you for taking the time out to be with us. It's actually the last time we chatted was July last year. Seems like some time ago, but I don't know, it's still quite fresh in my head. So,
good to know.
You know, when we last talked, the last time, it was about encounter and conversations. And they've been, of course, I think, a critical part of the entire discernment for this 10-year pastoral plan. Father, for our viewers and listeners, right, who maybe for the first time are even listening or hearing about the APC, the Archdiocesan Pastoral Council, can you share with us how the APC has been carrying out its work with parishes and other archdiocesan organizations, and even with the religious and the laity as well?
Yeah. Thank you, Andre. Good morning, Beatrice. Andre.
Good morning.
You know, when you asked and you said that the importance of the conversation pieces, right? I think a large part of our work for the first half, which is from last year, right? Mostly of last year, has been about conversations.
Yeah.
And that's because we've adopted a pastoral methodology to enter into this work we do. A lot of our work is really to hear what's on the ground, right? To come up close to them like Jesus does, and then to look at the realities of where people are with their faiths, their pastoral needs. And that's a little bit like Jesus coming with the tenderness to encounter, to understand. And then finally, like with the compassion of Jesus, to respond, right? Those three movements, yeah?
Right.
So for most of last year, it was to listen, to come down to listen to the realities. And that's because we adopted the See, Judge Act.
Right.
For most of last year, it was about seeing.
Right.
Seeing and listening. And we listen in two specific ways, really. On the one hand, we listen to the people of God and where God is meeting them, what their needs are, and what perhaps are their hopes for the future of the church too. So we ran a couple of engagement sessions, about 20, what we call encounter and conversations with religious, with laity, with church workers, with the priests as well. And that's been a very important part of trying to sense what the invitation the Lord is making to us in discerning a pastoral plan.
Correct.
But the other listening, of course, is listening to Jesus.
Yeah.
And prayer is such an important part of our work, you know, that we do. And I wonder, Mingla, how you do you think about this too, that we've been doing this listening, conversation, engagement as well?
Yeah.
Thanks very much for that, Father Dan. Good morning, Andre.
I'm in love. Welcome again.
It's good to be back again, and as I say, it's familiar grounds for us by now, I guess.
Good. I'm glad. I'm glad.
Yeah. It's... whole work of the APC, I think it is not just about a production of the 10-year plan. It's not about a council coming together, sitting down and thinking, well, these should be the directions, and coming up with a plan on paper.
Right.
A large part of the work of the APC is also about a process. A process that engages the church, because it's about partnership. And it's about partnership with the clergy, partnership with the religious orders, partnership with the laity.
Right.
And this partnership has been critical for us, because this process of discernment requires the thoughts, the perspective, the views of different members of the church. If we are, at the end of the day, to produce a 10-year plan that is of the church. And this discernment process includes looking at what God wants us to do, the hopes that He wants us to move towards, how He wants us to behave, how He wants us to change. And so it goes back to what Father Danker said, that even as we draw in the inputs of those around us,
right. The
clergy, the religious, the laity, it's important to bring him back and see where God is leading us together as a church.
Right. But the diversity, you know, the breadth of you know, that sort of consultation, I mean, it must have taken you all a long while to assimilate all that came back to you.
Mm-hmm.
And so with that process going on, it's very much synodal, isn't it?
And I like how also, like you mentioned about partnership, right? So Father, maybe we can come to you, you know, this partnership of listening, engagement and discernment. And we're talking about the different levels in the church community. Mm-hmm. And Andre also has also just mentioned a reflection of the synodal process, you know, which is still ongoing in the worldwide church. Father, could you share with us, were there any outcomes that from this partnership of listening, engagement and discernment?
I could share that, but before that, you know, let's look at that process of the synodal process, yeah, because it's relatively new to the diocese, it's seemingly new to the church, right? And there's a lot of misunderstanding, confusion. I think if we look at the synodal process, it's something that's always been part of the church. From the very beginning, the very first Christian communities gathered together to try to listen to where the Holy Spirit was inviting them to be Christian, both as community, both as church, both in how, in the way they live, in the way they engage each other, the way they do mission. And that process is something as simply put as how the Holy Father has put it in one of his points. It's the image of the people of God walking together, the people of God questioning, Lord Jesus, how do you want us to live? Lord Jesus, how do you want us to be Christian? How do you want us to go and evangelize? And also then taking responsibility as a Christian community of doing that communal discernment to sense where Jesus is and how they are going to respond to the call to live, to do mission, right? And to be Christian. So the engagements have really been listening to all these different voices. And you're right, it's diverse. It's very diverse, very rich, actually. One of the beautiful things that comes out about their voices is that they give us, as Ming Lak was saying, that invitation to see ourselves as partners on a journey with the Holy Spirit and with Jesus.
Yeah, yeah.
And that has allowed us to then hear all these different voices, not as diverse and you know, opposing each other, but rather as the richness of the diversity of the church. And that's important because one of the things about the Catholic Church is that we understand diversity, right, and inclusivity of all these views as part of the way we are church.
Yeah.
A welcoming, accepting church that's on a journey together. And the richness of that allows us to see all the different ways the gifts come together, the charisms, the perspectives. And that's been important for us.
Correct.
But we are building on the process of a conversation that has already been going on even before this process.
Mm.
If you can remember, we've had conversations in the past as a diocese.
That's right.
Right, SG 2000, right? The synodal process in 2022, all this have been allowing us to hear these voices as well. And from there, what we did was together as a APC and then say there are four areas that we really want to go into, really. Discipleship, families and communities, mission and evangelization, and structures and support for how we are going to be a diocese. And that has resulted in the good work of many people in the SGs. As Ming Lak often says, and you know, we are very aware that this work we do is not the two of us or even the council, it's people in study committees in these four study groups.
Right.
Working hard, producing something like 30 different topics for us to discuss at the APC meeting. And they've had over 40 different meetings, you know, just meeting to work on this. But it's the work that they do. And in fact, the work is beyond the study groups even. They go and listen and conduct surveys to different groups like the singles, the divorced, the widowed. The foreign workers, the foreign families, those on the margins of our church, those who have lapsed and come home, because we want to hear this diversity.
Absolutely. Right?
And to your point, how do we hold the richness? It's quite a challenge.
I can only imagine, right? And the amount, as I said, the amount of data, also the material that has come from there. But I'm just wondering, how are you sustaining yourselves and keeping the groups and teams working in alignment and in union with each other? I mean, it's huge, Minla.
I think the simple answer to that is that we don't.
Okay, I like that.
Yeah, by the grace of God.
Amen, yeah.
And I mean, with all sincerity, we couldn't have done it by ourselves. Yeah. But I think I've said it before, and it continues to be so. It's a constant theme. It's this whole APC work, at least for me, has been a journey of God saying, come along and see what marvelous things I can do for my church.
Yeah.
Mm.
Given the diversity of views that we've had, you could have expected a lot more divergence. But the interesting thing is that in the midst of all that diversity and divergence, when people focus on who we follow, we come together, we converge, because there is that anchor. And I think that was starkly so when at the end of our C phase, we held a retreat. We held a two-day retreat. And Father Danker and some of the spiritual directors guided us through. And a lot of time was spent not on discussion, there was discussion time, but a lot of time was on prayer, individual prayer as well as group prayer. And to me, what was amazing was that at the end of all the prayers, when I think something like 14 different groups, prayer groups, comprising of laity, church workers, religious, people from religious orders, clergy came together, there was commonality of themes. And it was quite stark as every group presented, such that when we summarized the themes, all the groups, 14 different groups comprising of people from different parts of the church came together and said, yeah, I think that's what's on our hearts. So that can only come by God bringing us together.
Absolutely. I mean, the Holy Spirit must have been working overtime. You know, I mean, but I mean, really, bringing people together. I mean, it's just amazing that for the church to come together and to be able to work in that manner, you know, I think it's only a microcosm of what can happen, you know, when this goes down to the entire Archdiocese. I mean, I'm praying that it is a possibility for us. But I mean, just that example that you cited, Minlak, I think that gives us also, for us, great hope. Right? And so, you know, the sisters and brothers, the thing is, it's not just these groups, right? These 14 groups that are all these, you know, different people that whom you've brought together, Father and Minlak, under the APC. But each and every one of us has a part to play. And the thing is, we have to, we may not be able to see ourselves maybe immediately in the areas that we could possibly fit into. But if our hearts are open and if we are accepting to the movement of the Spirit, I think great things can happen and will happen.
And you're right, you know, the invitation for the APC is not just the work of the council, the study groups, all those who've been assisting us, but it's really the whole diocese. And one of the things we've been inviting everyone in the diocese to do is actually to pray. Because this is the work of the Holy Spirit, right? And as Minlak says, by the grace of God. And truly it is the grace of God that has moved, but the grace of God has come through the people of God. I mean, we are convinced because every month since the APC began, we've actually been inviting the whole diocese to pray the prayers of the faithful. There's always one particular special prayer.
You remember, right? Yes, indeed.
And they look at the different parts or the different folk side that we want, right, or we're concentrating on.
Right.
So we do that with the hope that everybody is part of the process of discerning and praying with us as well.
Yeah.
And for this work that we do as a diocese.
Right.
But more than that, we've also been a little bit more focused. So last year we had 5 nights of intercessory prayers in 5 different churches across the island.
Yes.
Coming to pray for specific themes, right? In each of the study groups and the themes that they were looking at.
Yeah.
And that was so important because it was gathering of not just the parish where we had it, but people from outside the parish.
Right.
And it was led by clergy, also with lay. I mean, I think that idea of coming together, praying together is so important before Jesus, and to just hear what the Lord is inviting us to do. So truly the work is not just the sitting down, the looking at the documents, the data, and trying to figure out. It's also the work of the Holy Spirit. And I think, as Minglak rightly said, we want this to be a collective effort of everybody.
Indeed.
And you're right, Andre. Not all of us can be present for these works, but prayer, prayer is which is what everyone can do, is so important.
Absolutely.
For this work, because it is the work of the Spirit for the diocese. With the diocese, yeah.
Yeah.
Mm. And so later on, we'll be also sharing the dates on when this intercessory prayers will be happening and where it'll be happening. But for now, if you've just joined us on a faith perspective, we've been speaking with the co-chairs of the Archdiocesan Pastoral Council, Father Adrian Danker and Kwek Min Luck. And we've been speaking about how the APC has been carrying out its work with parishes, archdiocese organizations, religious and the wider Catholic community. Father, could you share with us now the direction and priorities of these themes that sort of took the participants toward, and was there an underlying theme, since we're talking about like convergence as well, that encompassed the work of the APC and all the collaborators?
Mm-hmm. You know, one points that Min Luck made earlier was how 14 different groups gathered for the retreat, bringing together all the diverse views from the different engagements, the study groups, right? And over the 2 days at the retreat, the Holy Spirit moved us to kind of land on some common themes.
Right.
I think the key focus throughout the retreat and ever since the APC began has been clearly to look at the person of Jesus, to look at the person of Jesus who's really at the center of our lives and inviting us to really center this work on Him, but to listen to Him who invites us to discern how we want to be a church as He would like it. So I think the rallying point, and often Mingla and myself talk about, at the end of the day, the pastoral plan has to be spiritual. There has to be a spiritual rallying point.
Yeah.
And it's not a point, it's a person. It's the person of Jesus, right?
Amen.
And so what gathers all the different themes that have come up and center and grounded is the person of Jesus. So we focus the work that we're doing in now the second phase, the judge phase, where we're discerning really the priorities with greater clarity and also stating it out in the document, right? Which is a working document, is being with Christ, building the kingdom of God. Being with Christ, building the kingdom of God.
No, that's...
Because Christ has to be the center, right?
Absolutely. Yes.
And this work is Christ. Our church is with Christ. We are with Christ because we say we are Christians. And so one of the things that Christ talks about is always that He has come for the people of God. And that outward movement is not just about reaching out. It's building the kingdom of God in the here and now. And one of the things that we are aware, and the invitation that came out from the retreat, was to ask ourselves, if this is the mission of Jesus, then we probably have to look at ourselves with great honesty, whether we are maintaining the church here, or whether the Lord is challenging us as a diocese to really be a little bit more intentional and more giving in the sense, and more focused on really building the kingdom of God. His vision is always outward. His vision is going to the peripheries, to the boundaries of the church where the people are, the people that have not been included, the people who have been marginalized, but at the same time, bringing everybody along as well, because we are church. And this vision, in a way, is not so different really from the way Pope Francis, actually, at the conclave, before he was elected, when he was Cardinal Bergoglio, he said in his speech at the conclave, we have a choice. We have a choice of a church, he said to the cardinals, of a choice of a church that looks inward, maintains ourselves, or really hear the call of the Holy Spirit to go to the frontiers, and in that movement, realize the kingdom of God.
Indeed.
So all these resonances, right? I think the work we do, Pope Francis's perspective, the synodal process, tells us that really what grounds us is really Christ. And He has to be our center.
It has to be, yeah. You know, too often we get, I feel, in church world, we were caught up in the work. And the person of Christ sometimes can literally also just be pushed to the side and forgotten. And then that's why we become sometimes impersonal in, you know, the way we minister to one another or to others. And so I hear you that there were certain priorities that came across. Min Luck, can I ask you, can you share that with us?
Certainly. I think as we reflected on this theme, with Christ building the kingdom of God, there were certain things that struck us as important, as priorities that we need to look at in order to really move towards this goal, towards this vision. And the first one that was really on our hearts was really about unity.
Right.
Unity in diversity, But unity across all different parts of the church, unity within the clergy, between the clergy and the religious orders, with laity, unity between all the archdiocesan organizations, unity between the archdiocesan organizations and the parishes, between the parishes, across all different aspects of the church. And that is important because it goes back to what Father Danker is saying. Are we about maintaining the church? Are we building the kingdom of God? I guess if we say that we are about maintaining the church, then, well, we may not need to do so much.
Absolutely.
But if having followed Christ and hear his call, and he says, that's what I'm calling you to do, and we know that the mission is much larger than each and every one of us as individuals or as units of the church can do, then it calls us to be together. We emphasize unity and diversity because it so goes back to what Father Danker said, that there is a richness in the church. And there is, I think, a certain power if that richness, that diversity can come together in a unified vision moving together. And so the first thing was about unity in diversity across all different parts of the church. The second and related part is about building up the differentiated co-responsibility of the clergy and the laity. The work of the church building the kingdom of God is large. And I think, speaking for me as a member of laity, we cannot say that, well, if that's our vision, if that's where we want to go, we support our priests, we pray for them, all the very best.
And then,
and
then we go to church and then, well, there is a lot more that we can do.
Definitely.
Support them, and I think it is necessary. We've spoken to priests and they've shared that, yes, we appreciate the help of the laity in finance administration, but there's pastoral work that we need to do as well. If really we are about reaching out to the margins, if, let's say, one of the priests shared with me, if I want to reach out to the migrant workers, and they can't come for our usual RCIA hours, someone has to reach out to them.
Absolutely.
If only a few priests are the only ones who reach out, where are they going to find to reach out? So I think it is a call for us as a laity to take on that call from Christ as well.
Indeed.
With that, it also means a recognition that there is a need for formation. And that's the third point. There's a need for formation, of course, for priests. There was discussion about formation for priests in terms of administration so as to help them with the running of the parishes. But on the part of the laity, formation in terms of spiritual formation, theological formation, so that we have a better understanding about how to help grow the church.
Yes.
Because while for many of us, we come with corporate experience, and that can be useful. It is also important to understand the context and the history and the direction of the church so as to be effective when we are actually helping the church to grow. And that, again, leads to a third related priority, and that's about lifelong formation. One of the things we looked at, well, we talk about from lifelong formation for the clergy, not just after they finish seminary, and for the laity, not just after confirmation. Oftentimes we say, well, that's the marker. After confirmation, when you finish your catechism, you're done, you're graduated. After that, you're more or less on your own.
But that's a sad state of things, actually, in a sense, because we lose so many at that point. But I think what we are doing now is trying to really keep them. And if we have communities that allow them to express themselves as well within the church, maybe that might change.
And what you said is important, this thing about communities, it's a fourth point. And I'll come to that shortly. But this thing about formation for the laity, one of the things that has struck us and which came from, I think, the study groups and the prayers is that we need to look at formation of laity across our lifetime, across key milestones. Not just the time when you're 15, but to see what kind of formation support we can provide. At different points of people's life, when they're facing different challenges, when they're entering into different aspects of their life, whether it's in terms of family, in terms of their work, facing children, all these things require a different type of formation, and there needs to be some level of support.
And even aging, actually, as
yeah.
well.
Yeah, yeah. True. Yeah.
Precisely. So aging, one of the things that came up in our studies was that this is going to be a big thing for us. If you look at the demographics of the church, following in line with where we are in Singapore, you have less younger people. Mm. You have more older people. And that is equally true of the church. A lot of our church members are the older members. Right. And if you are losing the younger ones, in time to come, you have an inverted demographic pyramid.
Correct.
And so that is something that we need to look at.
Yeah.
And so formation at different milestones is important. Making sure that there's proper ministry that is provided for those who age is important.
Mm. Yeah.
And the point that you said, Andre, this thing about communities, that's actually a fourth priority that came up. This thing about communities. We need to form communities of faith within the parish, across different interest groups, because our faith is not a standalone faith. Yeah.
Absolutely.
It's a faith that comes through a community, and you can see that from the first days of the apostles.
Mm.
And then related to that, this fifth thing about this process. And it goes back to what Father Danker said, synodality.
Yeah.
As a community, that's how we journey. So synodality is, I think, also a reflection of the fact that for us as followers of Christ from the early days, we were called together as a community, not as individuals.
Mm. Right.
And so that synodal process allows us to be a church together as we look to accomplish all these things, following the calling and voice of God.
Mm.
You know, very naughtily, as you were saying, as you were sharing with us, I was also looking at Matthew 6:33, which says, "Seek ye first the kingdom of God, and then all these things shall be gathered unto you." And it sounds as though, you know, you have done so much work. You've tilled the soil, you've fertilized it, you've sown the seeds, and, you know, but the year is still very young. 2023 is still very young. And so with the Holy Father, who is going to be in our midst, can I ask you what is in store for the APC and the Church of Singapore?
I think with the themes that we developed, the priorities that we spoke about, and also bearing in mind the synodal process, what we have been doing is preparing a draft document. In church terms, it's called a schema.
Right.
And the schema is basically a document that contains the hopes, the ideas, possibilities of the directions that the church could move to.
Right.
Not so much detailed programmatic recommendations, but about key directional shifts that the church should make.
This is not an instrumentum laboris, It's not at all. Okay.
So it's something that I think it's in even more draft form.
Yes.
Right. Okay.
Because it's intended to contain that summary of the ideas, the possibilities, the directions that we could be moving to,
right,
and to bring it out to the members of our church. And so we'll bring the schema to the communities of our church over the course of this year. We'll bring it to the clergy, we'll bring it to the religious orders, to the church workers, and the members of the laity. And with each and every round of engagement, we will build the schema.
Yeah.
Mm.
So the first time round that we go to the clergy, it may be schema 1.0.
Mm.
After that, once we take in the inputs, when we next have the next engagement, it'll be maybe schema 2.0. And so we'll build it along the way. And the intent is that by the time, hopefully, we reach the second half, we would have engaged the clergy, the religious orders, the church workers, and then we'll bring it to the district levels.
Mm.
And after we have district level discussions on the schema, we are hoping that the parishes themselves can have their own discussions, their own assemblies about it. Before we all converge, hopefully sometime next year, maybe the first half of next year, at the archdiocesan level, for everybody to come to discuss the schema, by which time it would have taken in different levels of inputs from all the different engagements. And after we have that Archdiocesan assembly on the schema, then the APC will pull together all the inputs into a draft pastoral plan for the Archbishop's consideration.
Right. Oh, I mean, I think that sounds a wonderful idea. It means that this instrument, this schema, is going to be a live document,
so to speak.
Mm.
Yes, very much so.
It not necessarily morph, but it'll be improved on as we move along.
Yeah.
And that just sounds absolutely really what church should be, isn't it?
It's what church should be, right? As
organic.
Organic, but also, I think, right, listening. In a very Ignatian way, it is the way of the church. It is the way to constantly listen to the message.
Yeah.
Right? And when you begin this part and you ask the question, the Pope is coming, what does it all mean?
Yeah.
You know, I've been reflecting on that. Everybody says, the Pope's coming, the man is coming.
Yeah.
But really the focus is on the message.
Correct.
What is the message that he's going to tell us from the Lord for us as a diocese?
Absolutely.
And the same way, the work we're doing with the schemas, with the engagements, with the revisions, the fine-tuning, getting finally to an AA, Archdiocesan Assembly, and then having that larger communal discernment, right?
Yeah.
The whole process of listening to the message. What exactly is this message that Jesus is inviting us to hear from one another, to be humble enough to say, that's better than mine, or maybe I have to give this up, to fine-tune it, to become really the message that Jesus wants to say, this is the Diocese of Singapore. This is how I would love you to be community and church, to care for the people in the margins, on the margins, the people who are already in church, how you are to go out and build the kingdom.
Absolutely.
But to do that, I think the message he has always been saying from the beginning of the APC is, pray.
Yeah.
Please pray. Because without the prayer, it's not about me, it's about all of you.
Great.
But I have something to say, right? And what I really want to say is so good that, can you please go to prayer?
Mm.
And so one of the things that we want to invite everybody as we continue this work is to continue praying with us and for us, for the diocese as well, that as we do the communal discernment, we are very clearly focused on the person of Christ. For with him, we build the kingdom of God.
Indeed.
Right? And therefore, this year, we will continue with the intercessory prayers in 5 parishes across the diocese as well. The prayers of the faithful will still continue every month.
Yes.
I'm hoping now, because we've been able to share another time, that with this message, the people will come together with us to pray. I think one of the things that I've been most humbled about is the fact that prayer has worked so much in what we do.
Yeah.
And as Mingla says, we've been amazed by how the Holy Spirit has led this and done the work. Just a final thing. This last few days, I've been listening to a song. I have it on repeat. That's the way I listen to music. Mm. And the song is by a composer called Will Todd. He's English. He's a choral, classical, jazz composer.
Mm.
The song, The Call to Wisdom, was a song he wrote for the Diamond Jubilee of the Queen in 2012.
Oh.
It's based on Proverbs 8. But the refrain, the continuing refrain is, I am here, I am here, I have called. Can you hear me? I am here.
Wow.
And I've been thinking about that refrain because it's really also what we're called to do in the APC.
Mm.
That he is here with us, not just very near, but here with us. He has something to say. He wants to help us be a better diocese. Can we listen to him?
Yeah. And like you said, Father, you know, and in Minlak also, at the end of the day, this construct, whatever you want to call it, is a movement not towards a thing or a work, but it's towards a person.
Yeah.
And it's the person of Jesus, really. I sense there is a certain excitement, I think, you know, that's picked up. And I think, but like all Catholics, you know, we just want to sit in the pew and then wait for things to drop on us. Any last words, you know, before we go, if you can, you know, share with our brothers and sisters, is there anything else that we as church you think could do in helping to facilitate, you know, the work that you all are doing? And how can we be agents of this movement or this change that needs to come about?
I think we would encourage everybody who hears about the APC work, who hears about the schema, to take a look at the document, to reflect on it, pray on it, and share with us your thoughts. Because as you've put it very elegantly, Andre, it's a living document. That's what we want. And it's a living document because this whole process is about the church coming together to build a plan. It's not about the APC coming up to build a plan. It's about the APC creating a process where the church can come together and build its plan. And for that to do so, then all the members of our church, we hope, can take part in that. And not just because it helps us to formulate that plan, but also because I hope that in that process, whoever joins in this journey will also see that excitement, that hope that we have faced. You asked earlier, how did we bring people together? And oftentimes it's people who come to us and say, you guys should carry on because I've been so touched by it, and we are quite amazed. We are the ones who are encouraged by those who reflect on it and tell us that this is the direction that you guys should be going. And there is a certain hope, excitement, joy, passion that they've imbibed from being in this journey. And we hope that for those who joined, whether it's joining us in the intercessory prayers or taking part in the discussions about the schema, that hope of Christ, that passion of Christ will similarly flow as they take part in this process.
You know, I myself, just listening to, you know, your sharings, both of you, Father Adrian and Mindak, already it excites me as well. And for Beatrice and I, I'm sure, you know, it's not just because we work here or anything of that sort, but the amount of work and dedication that has gone into it, I think is, you know, immeasurable. You know, and the different people who have sat together, it's a miracle in itself. You know, and so again, dear sisters and brothers, I turn to you again because you have a part to play. You have a part to play. Each and every one of us has a part to play, you know, and if we want to get into the boat with Jesus and the rest of everyone else, you not only have to have life, you know, floats and what have you and all that, but you've got to swim as well. I'm going to invite you to swim along and come along and be part of the current, maybe to carry this boat and to move us as church forward together, right? And so once again, I'm going to thank Father Adrian, Danker, Minlak, thank you once again, also again for being with us.
Thank you.
And I just want to affirm both of you, and if I can, the whole APC, for the wonderful work that you all are doing. We are grateful because we know that, you know, as part of the church, we are going to benefit from it. And the church can only become a better witness of the Lord if He is the person that we move closer towards. So thank you so much for this. And dear sisters and brothers, we're going to invite you also to, you know, if you've missed, and this is just the end that you're catching, we want you to know that you can also watch The Faith Perspective, because it goes out every fortnight, today at 8:30, and then tonight at 8 p.m., you'll be able to catch it. Tomorrow, Wednesday at 5 p.m., and also on Thursday at 2:10. But if you miss all of that as well, you have no excuse because it's going to be on podcast. Plus, it's also going to be on our YouTube channel.
Yes, that's right. And before we go, we promise to share with you the dates of the upcoming intercessory prayers. Okay. So it has already begun on 9th April, actually, at St. Joseph's Church, Victoria Street. The next one that you want to take note, put a note in your calendar. This one will be at the Church of the Holy Cross on Friday, 3rd of May. That's actually next week, isn't it?
Yes.
8 p.m.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. 3rd May, 8 p.m. Now, there are various dates that we will also share with you on our Facebook. So keep a lookout for that one.
We'll also remind you every now and then on our program. So we'll keep you updated. Not to worry.
Yeah. That's right.
So thank you so much for joining us here on The Faith Perspective. I'm Andrea Church. She's Beatrice De Cruz. Thank you so much for joining us here on Catholic SG Radio. You take care and God bless and love you all. Bye-bye.
Bye.